All right, if you're all ready, we're going to go ahead and get started. Good morning, everyone. My name is Al Khari. I'm a global cloud evangelist with Microsoft. And my partners in this session are Cambiz and Will, who are around the room helping everyone. If you need help, please reach out, raise your hand. They're going to be available to help you out with any issues if you run into them. This is a lab. Yes, and they are with Red Hat, and as the logo saw it, state. So this is a lab. If you have any difficulties, please reach out. The intent is for us to walk through the lab together. If anybody is behind or needs a little bit extra time, please let us know. We'll slow down to your pace. The lab is simple and straightforward. It's intended to be really easy to go through and has little complications. Hopefully, we won't go through a lot of trouble. The lab is going to be on building microservices using Atomic, and we're going to be using two versions. We're going to use Fedora 23 and CentOS Atomic Host 7. The environment is online on tristack.org, an OpenStack sandbox where you could go and try out applications and do testing for whatever it is that you want to test on OpenStack. It's available for public, and you could try it at home if you like. If you would like to follow with me, and if you want to see the slides on your laptop, they're on pochub.com. And we're going to be using another link here with the steps. So if you have that in the back window in your browser, it will be handy when we get to it. RHEL Atomic, CentOS Atomic, and Fedora Atomic run a full stack of Kubernetes, Docker. Go ahead.
A few people are asking about the passwords already, and I just wanted to mention that it's going to be up on one of the subsequent slides, but it's redhat123 for any passwords if anybody's curious.
All the passwords are going to be redhat123 today. So whenever you have a password, redhat123. We will use Kubernetes, which is an orchestration engine that will allow us to run a cluster of Docker containers or Docker hosts. We're using Docker for running those containers, and we are going to be utilizing etcd for a data store. For those of you who are not familiar with it, it's a very simple data store that allows you to store key value pairs and restore them from wherever you want using API calls. Used mainly for networking, so networks can store their configuration and restore them from the different containers and the different objects within our environment. Flannel is what we've selected for this lab to run our overlay network. For those of you who are familiar with Open vSwitch, Flannel is a really miniature version of it. It's a simple overlay network. We're going to be using it at a very lightweight. We'll run VXLAN tunnels between our containers. It allows you access to the containers from within the hosts and for containers to talk to one another. For our lab architecture today, and please pardon the layout, it got messed up when I moved to Windows. So we're going to have three nodes to work with today, three VMs that are hosted on TriStack. Those VMs are just standard instances on an OpenStack environment. We are using only a small version, a small size, because there's many of us, and the environment needs to handle all of us doing all kinds of stuff at the same time. Our master node is where we'll be logging into, and it's a Fedora instance that has a full operating system stack with a floating IP address connected via the router from the outside world. And this is where you're going to be logging into the environment from. We're going to be using a terminal session, whether that's on your Mac or a PuTTY session on your PC, or if you're using Linux, you're lucky. We're going to build a registry of Docker, so we are not a registry cache for Docker, so we're not pulling container images all the time from Docker. We're going to store it locally on one of our nodes. That's the registry on the right, and we can deploy as many minions as we like. We're only going to deploy one today. Minions are your Docker nodes, and they are where your containers are going to be running. Because we're limited to three today, we are going to run the master also as a Docker node. So the master will also be a minion. From OpenStack, if you already logged in to www.tristack.com, I'm sorry, www.x86.tristack.org, with the username that you have on that small piece of paper and Red Hat 123 password, you will see this. You will see the environment. You will see instances have already been started for you and pre-configured with a name resolution and with the software we're going to be using today. So the software is pre-installed. The network topology will show you how the current network is laid out. It's a little prettier in this version of OpenStack. This is Liberty. So we got the router, our network, and our three nodes, and this is how we're getting into the environment from the network, from the internet. I'm gonna spare you with the slides. We're gonna get into the lab very quickly, so the slides were just to get you oriented. So here are the details for logging in. Your username is Red Hat 123. I'm sorry, your username is whatever is on that piece of paper, and Red Hat 123 is your password. To log in to the master, it uses Fedora for a user, and use your public IP address that you have on that piece of paper. For the registry and Minion 1, those nodes are on the internal network, and you'll be able to log into them from within master only. You're unable to log in? Can we get new credentials here and here, please? Can please?
So one thing to note, make sure you're going to www.x86, not just x86. We actually have two parallel OpenStack implementations.
Yeah, if you forgot the www, you're logging into past version. This is the most recent. Was everybody able to log in? Anyone still not logged in? Okay, for public use, tristack.org is when you get back home, and the full lab setup is on digirates.com if you want to configure your VMs or install software. We skipped those steps for you because installing software takes some time, and we wanted to save you that wait time here. It also puts a lot of strain on the resources of the environment, so if all of us are doing it at the same time, makes it a little bit crawl. Also, please remember to sudo everything as we're going through this. We're logging in as a non-privileged user, so we're going to need to run everything with root access, so please use sudo. All right. If I can ask you to please go to the URL below that pochub.com/steps.txt, I put the text for the lab in a txt file, so you guys can copy and paste and not have to do a lot of typing. Do I get a thank you for that? All right, so the text file is open here. I hope you could see it well. Yeah. And I'm going to be using PuTTY.
Also, just to be clear, if you have issues getting into the Horizon dashboard, the student number is going to be your tenant. So that's going to be specific to you. But Red Hat 123 will be the password for there. And then the Fedora user or the other users are going to be for your actual instance that's running on OpenStack.
So we're going to walk through this lab together. If anybody is not yet at the login prompt to master, please raise your hand. Okay, I think we're all logged in. And if I can do something here to make this a little bit bigger. All right. Is the display okay? Is everyone okay seeing this? All right. So we'll walk through this together. Please let me or one of my peers know if you're behind, so we'll slow down and get back and catch with you. So, but the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to log into my registry. We're going to build the registry first because that's where our Docker images are going to be stored. And it's the easiest, frankly, to build. So we'll take us only a few minutes to go through this, and then we'll get to configuring our master and nodes. So I'm going to SSH to my registry with Red Hat 123 as the password. And if I'm at the registry prompt now, I could start configuring that. First, I'm going to start copying and pasting. So if you guys want to do the same thing or if you feel like typing, please have at it. Please copy, if you're copying from the text file, after the space following the dollar sign. Do not copy the text that has the host name. It's only there to show you which host you're going to be putting that information into. What we're doing here is just, as I mentioned, we're replicating a cache for the Docker registry so we can have our images downloaded locally and not have to go out to Docker every time we download stuff. You see here it's downloading all of the repos, and it's going to take only a few seconds, and we should be all set. Say that again, please.
For those of us that are not experienced with Docker, what does the Docker create command do? Can you explain that?
So right now we're just creating a repository, a local cache. We're not creating any containers. We're not creating any fancy stuff. We're just pulling Docker into a new container that services all of the Docker repos into the environment. We do that only as a cache. So As we go to the next steps, we won't be pulling images directly from Docker all the time. This is a one time. Basically. Yeah, yes. Okay, mine is done. Who else is done? Okay, some are still going through. So if yours is done, you could start configuring that service. The next step, we're going to create a local service for that container so we can start using it to service requests locally. There's a little bit of text here that creates that service and starts it in your current kernel and runs it. I'm just going to copy it and paste it. And it shouldn't take very long. And then we're going to just start enable and start the services. We'll reload the daemon and enable and start the services. I did not wait long enough. So it's loaded and started. I'm going to set SE Linux context for it, so we don't have any conflict. And that's that. Once you get to that point, your registry is configured and ready to go. In the past 5 minutes or so since we started this exercise, we just downloaded all of Docker here. So you have a cache now that allows you to launch any Docker image from right here. This is one of the strengths. This is something that makes containers so powerful. They're so lightweight, so mobile, and so flexible. It takes only this long and this many commands to actually pull the entire repository down. I am going to wait a couple of minutes. If anybody is still not ready, please let us. Okay. Keep going. It's loading. Yeah, there's a ton of us doing it at the same time. The good news, the rest of the environment is pre-installed with all the software, so we're not going to have a lot of bottlenecks like this. Anyone not complete yet? Okay, we'll wait.
Al, the slide that you're on with the steps, is that Is that hyperlinked on the slide page, or is that still you have to cut and paste?
The steps, right there. It's pochub.com.
Right. Is it hyperlinked? So can you just click on it? You mentioned you were going to change that, so you can actually.
You may have to type it. Somehow the link isn't working. I'm sorry about that.
No problem.
I'm not going to blame this one on Windows. It's me. Go ahead. Cambiz, will you give her the microphone, please?
Meantime that we are waiting, is it possible to go through some slide or something that give us like kind of a little introduction and high level what we are trying to accomplish today?
I did not prepare slides. This was intended to be a hands-on lab. So I didn't really bring slides to walk through any theory. This is really about rolling up your sleeves and doing it. So my apologies, I did not prepare for that.
So I think as we go through the lab, maybe if you're also going through it, you can kind of explain, like you did with me, what it is really that's going on behind the scenes as the various components are spun up.
Certainly. Okay, makes sense. There's also one thing I haven't mentioned. This environment is going to be available for about a week after the summit. And you can keep the credentials. You could change the password if you like, something that you're comfortable with. And if you like to try things out and test with it, we're only going to have it for 1 week after the summit. So feel free to test with the same thing. But beyond the summit, if you want to try things out again, tristack.org is available and open. You could build on it from scratch. Do we still have anyone who's not done with? I see four people, five people. Okay. Is anyone way ahead of us? Oh, cool. All right. Okay, one more minute before we keep going. All right, just curious, anybody still not done? I see only two people, three people. I'm going to go ahead and get going, and for those who are still waiting for it, I hope you can catch up with us. Please ask Cambiz or Will for help if you're done, so they can help you get there faster. The next step, I'm going to be working in my master right now, so let me move this up so you see where we are. First thing we're going to, so I did not have time to set SE Linux context for our lab. We're going to simply set SE Linux to permissive in this case. And make that, we're going to make it permanent and set it to, set its enforce to permissive. There's a hand in the back, Cambiz, if you please, or Will, if you please check all the way in the back. I'm going to enable Docker and Cockpit. Has anybody here heard of Cockpit? So Cockpit is part of Atomic. It's a dashboard interface for Kubernetes. It basically is very similar to Horizon for OpenStack. It's just a pretty interface. You're just going to enable it and start it. And now we're going to start getting our hands dirty with configuration files. For the configuration files, I'm going to walk quickly through each line, what it's doing in the config files and why we're doing it. If you have questions, please stop me. The first thing we are going to, so I'm going to expand this so you all can see it. In etcd.conf, we're going to make it listen on all ports, on all network adapters, and we're going to listen on port 4001. Next thing, we're going to be configuring Kubernetes. Kubernetes is a has a very involved configuration options, and it's very flexible. It has a lot of details. So I cut the number of changes that we need to make to a handful that are really easy to apply, that will fit pretty much any environment. You can customize it to do a lot more, but for our purpose today, the customizations we're going to be making are going to be straightforward. Kubernetes has four configuration files: the config API, the controller manager, and the kubelet file. We'll talk about those in a second. We'll configure the config file first to make it listen on its IP address rather than the local host address. And then we're going to define the server port. So the first line is simply changing the 127.0.0.1 to 10.10.10.3, which is its IP address. And the second line is just defining who is the server. In this case, it is .3, our host. The API server file is where we configure the API endpoints. Just like you do in OpenStack, this is your API server. This is where all of the services are going to be talking to Kubernetes from. So first, we'll set it to listen on all addresses. And we'll tell it where its etcd server is. Remember, etcd is that key value store, so it can communicate with it. We'll give it an IP range for the cluster, so the instances that are created are going to be picking from that IP range. And then this line here has all the specific options for our setting. They are too detailed to go through, so if you're interested in what each one of them does, look at the documentation. But they basically help us do what we're trying to do today. And all the different options that are available, you're going to be changing in that line in admission control. So we're just going to copy that section. I'm sorry, I did not do the I did not back it up first. So backing up the original file and creating a new file. The controller manager file tells our Kubernetes host where the nodes are and where each one of them, how to find each one of them. So we're basically just telling it the machine IP addresses. The kubelet file is specific to the node itself. So for every minion, there is a kubelet file that tells it where to find its master. And this is where we just changing the local host to make it listen on all IP addresses. And we are changing the host name to master, in our case, with a fully qualified domain name. And we're setting the which network adapter is going to be listening on.
Small plug, because I've noticed that there's been a couple of speedy people that have gone through the lab. But just as an FYI, this is basically the new TriStack environment that's going to go online sometime next week. These accounts that you guys are using, they need to be deleted just to make room because we're basically at capacity. However, if you wanted to go through the lab again, or if you had someone that might be interested in seeing the work that Al's done to put it all together, please feel free to join TriStack. Currently, the authentication is done via a Facebook group. So if you're not averse to Facebook and you do have a Facebook account, look for the TriStack group and request to join, and then we'll approve your joining. Because if you noticed when you went to the Horizon page, there was a login with Facebook. So all the student accounts were set up statically outside of that. But if you're in the Facebook group, you'll get redirected to Facebook. And as long as you're logged in, you'll get sent back to TriStack. And then you'll be able to run through the lab for yourselves using your Facebook integrated account. I just wanted to mention that to everyone. Thank you.
One other thing, too. TriStack.org is a OpenStack Foundation project. So it's a completely volunteer effort. It's completely free. And you can use it to pretty much do whatever you like as long as it's within the tenets of a normal usage or legality. So.
I have to add also, they don't download your pictures from Facebook, so don't worry about that there. So next step, we're going to be enabling and starting the services. So these are the services that we have pre-installed for you: etcd, kube API server, kube controller manager, and scheduler, and kubelet. We're enabling and starting those services right now. Sure.
A comment, Alan, a request is that if you could share the list of packages that we pre-installed on the Fedora cloud image. So the cloud image is Fedora for the entry host.
Yeah.
And it's basically the vanilla cloud image. Plus, we kind of did some pre-installation of about 5 or 6 different packages, and I think Al's going to share those.
So I'm going to put these on the screen real quick. Okay, those are the packages that which we pre-installed for you. The Kubernetes, Docker, etcd, Flannel, Cockpit, and Cockpit Kubernetes.
Another issue that a lot of people seem to be running into is that during the start of the services, the Kube API server service, it spits out an error that it didn't start correctly. I'm not sure exactly if that's related to overall load on the TriStack platform with 200 accounts doing things at the same time, if something else is going on.
Did anybody get an error?
Yeah, they're getting an error, and it says that it failed to start and to look at the journal. But if they run the start command again, it just comes right back. And
okay.
If you look at the systemctl status on the service, it appears to be running. So
if something didn't start, please try again. Give it a kick next time. See if your laptop is slow or if the internet is slow. So far, we configured etcd and Kubernetes. The next component we'll configure is Flannel, our overlay network. Now, to configure Flannel, we're going to do some interesting things. We're actually going to push a JSON file to a key on the key value store we built in etcd, and then we're going to tell Flannel where that file is. In that JSON file, we're going to define the network for the overlay network. Down here it says it's VXLAN. You could use GRE if you want, but nobody does anymore. We're going to be using VXLAN, and we're going to use a /12 network, really big network. And then we're going to tell every host to have a /24 network, a tighter, smaller network. This way, all the networks can talk to one another. They're on the same subnet, they can talk to the host as well. Pushing that JSON file is just creating the file. Again, if you feel like launching VI and typing that file yourself, have at it. I'm gonna paste it here. A very simple text file in JSON, and I just typed it. And now we're going to push the configuration into etcd. We're going to use curl to do that. Curl with an uppercase L and -xput will actually push that file with that key name, atomic-key/network/config. You could call that Papa Smurf, if you like. You could call it anything you want, as long as you use the same name in the Flannel configuration. We'll use curl one more time to validate that our configuration were pushed. Is there a question?
They were asking if we could have multiple minions. And they said that
We'll configure one minion today, but you'll be able to add as many as you like to in your environment. The next line, we're testing our configuration using curl. And in our case, we're going to use a simple tool to make it look pretty, JQ there, that JSON query, to display it back in full colors. So this is a lookup into etcd right now, looking into that key value store and showing you what's in that key. And that's that. We're done with configuring our master. And next, we're going to be configuring minions. We spent about 5-10 minutes on the registry, roughly about 15-20 minutes on master. Minion should take us 10 minutes, and we should be ready to play. Well, there's a hand over there. Will? Is anybody done with master? Okay, good. We have 5 people at least. So the intent of this session is to give you the tools available to create a cluster really quickly if you have an environment already or if you want to test things out online. And once you got a cluster of Kubernetes running and you have a bunch of hosts and you're able to launch different containers and different applications, you get a feel for what the power of it and what it can do for you. And you can start testing things out very quickly. You don't have to make any investment to do that. All of the tools we're using today are open source. CentOS, Fedora, and Atomic are all open source projects that are available for download. On here, you can go and there's a link to go and download the images for Fedora and for CentOS. And also a link for the updated, so if you're building this a month from now, there's a new version, go to the link and download the most recent. But all of that is available at your disposal for free anytime. So you are way ahead. It will take a few minutes, but. Just out of curiosity, were you able to get to the cockpit dashboard? And are you seeing it in the? Okay. So it should theoretically reboot very quickly, but with so many of us in the environment, it may be taking a few minutes. Bless you. Is everyone done with master? Who's not done? Everybody is done with master. Okay, I'm gonna move on to the minion. And this is very quick. It should be simple. We're simply going to be doing the same things, pretty much, but in this case, we're only configuring the node without all these other services. So. First thing we're doing for the minion, we're going to tell it to not go to Docker to download containers, but go to our to our repository that we created at the beginning. And then we're going to tell. We're going to configure Flannel to use etcd and tell it where which network adapter to use. So notice here, this key right here, it says coreos.com for the original key that's packaged in Flannel. We're changing it with atomic key, which is the key we created that could have been Papa Smurf, as I mentioned. And next, we're going to just tell this minion where its master is. The kubelet file is where we give it its name, and we tell it its address, and where the master's address is.
The question here is that once we build this Nginx cluster inside of containers behind a load balancer, is that in this demo all in the private network, or did we do anything to set up on the Fedora host a port forward so they can actually literally hit that back-end cluster?
They can. It's not in the lab right now, but it's a couple of extra steps that could be done easily. So right now, it is not. It is just going to be internal. I'm sorry, go ahead. Is something here? OK, I think I'm done configuring. I'm going to be start enabling and starting the. I'm just going to enable and then reboot. So we are enabling FlannelD, the kube proxy, and the kubelet services. And I'm rebooting my instance. I think I'm behind some of you. A lot of you seem to have gone way past that.
There's a question on one of the steps where the FlannelD configuration file is modified using sed. And I'm wondering if at the time that the instructions were made, the vanilla configuration file may have included coreos.com. as opposed to atomic.io.
Can you go to that file and look at it, see what's in there, please?
Yeah. Well, so the Flannel etc key is /atomic.io/network. And I'm wondering if it needs to be something else.
It's this
like
file
atomic
right there?
Dash key. FlannelD.com. Right. And so you're trying to substitute coreos.com with atomic-key. But if you actually looked at the contents of the file on disk, there is not a coreos.com, but rather a atomic.io for
really?
The key. So if you could you look at that on yours, Al?
Yeah, I'm pulling it. It's still rebooting. Just give it 1 second. I'll log back into it.
Yes, we had another gentleman back here with a similar issue, and we went through Horizon and did a hard reboot. Did that host end up coming back? Somebody else who had that issue? Yeah, for those of you who are having issues with Dominion coming back, just as Al is as well, go into the Horizon interface for TriStack on www.x86.tristack.org. Log in with your student account and look at your instances and select Dominion 1 instance. And there's a small drop-down on the upper right corner. You can select the hard reboot option and reboot that instance. It should really only take, you know, 3 or 4 minutes for a reboot to come back and allow you to SSH from the Fedora host. So if that's not working, then you know, please try to use Horizon and do that hard reboot.
So what Cambiz is referring to is actually brute forcing it to reboot. For some reason, because there's so many of us working through it, apparently. It says machine restart, but it's hung there. So we can brute force it by going to instances on our dashboard. And then on the drop down on the left here, next to Minion, we can actually force it to reboot. Cambiz, did we use soft or hard reboot?
I guess maybe I use hard because I'm impatient, but I haven't had any issues with doing a hard reboot.
You can give it a strong kick if you like. You can always come back here and watch it reboot if you like. The console shows it to you as if you're looking at the bare metal. Is everybody else having the same problem I'm having? Rebooting that minion? Yeah, it does seem like it's refusing to reboot, for me at least. It's starting the boot process, but hanging there. Yeah, okay, please. So I promise you, when there aren't so many of us doing this, this takes only a minute.
That with this many people on as few compute nodes we have, we're
Sorry, Will, if you don't mind when you're done. Will? So regardless of Minion coming back up, it should have come up by now, but for some of us, it's taken a little while. We can still log into Cockpit and check things out if you like. Cockpit is running on master. It's running on port 9090 with the same IP address that's on here. So if you just put HTTP, this IP address, and port 1990 in your browser, you should be able to log into it. So here's the file. Which line was it? So to log into Cockpit, it's Fedora and Red Hat 123. That's it, done? So Cockpit is working on my environment, and it pops a certificate error because we're using a private certificate. Just ignore that and keep going. It shouldn't be a problem.
Al, the minions are optional, right? I mean, that's just to illustrate the fact that it's load balanced. Is that correct?
I can't hear you. I'm sorry.
The minions are optional if we were to shut them all down.
Yeah, you could run the environment without the minions because we're running the master as a minion. All what you will have is just a one node cluster.
So if everyone who's got a minion that's actually running wouldn't mind shutting them down going forward, just so that we can proceed with the rest. I think what we're seeing is a heavy load contention on the OpenStack infrastructure. There's only 7 nodes that are compute nodes, and there are 600 guests running to facilitate this environment. So it would help out. I think everyone would enjoy the rest of the demonstration if they just shut down their minion.
So let's do what Kambi is suggesting in the interest of time, so you all could see the actual cockpit. If we can shut down our minions, you can come back and start them later when not all of us are doing it at the same time, and try it out if you like. To shut them down, I'm just going to come back to my dashboard to instances, and I'm just going to click shut down. That's that simple. On minion one. And I'm going to shut it off. Can everybody see it? So they say demos are hard, labs are even harder. We didn't expect this contention in this number of people to occur, but we frankly didn't have a chance to test it with so many people either. So apologies if this didn't work as planned. But after the lab, if you have a few minutes during lunch break, if you launched your minion and went through the steps, you'll see it comes back up and it should perform. Oh, let's not all do it at lunch at the same time.
On the positive side, it's the first time I've seen a 320 load average on an OpenStack node, so that's always entertaining.
I'm going to go in Cockpit to the cluster node. I was going to show you how to add nodes. It's really straightforward. But I'm going to go to the cluster node here and demonstrate how to launch new applications. We're going to launch an Nginx web server. Really simple, straightforward, nothing special, nothing complicated, everything just out of the box. I'm going to keep this on the topology tab here just to show you what's going to happen when we launch that application. So just like in Docker, the command to run a new cluster. And in this case, we're not saying Docker run. We're saying kubectl run. Kubernetes will take over and will start multiple containers on the hosts that are available. Those hosts could potentially go offline. They could potentially have contention or whatever. The way Kubernetes work is it will actually restart services on other nodes when those nodes go down or are having resource contention. It's also going to schedule your containers based on resource availability. So if one host, in our case right now, we only have the one node to play with. But if you have multiple nodes, it will actually scale it across the environment based on resource load. We're going to do, in this case, this says 4 replicas. We're going to run 4 containers in a load balanced way. Just because we lost one node, we're working with one at this point. I'm going to ask you to do 2 for now. But if you feel like it after the lab is done and you're on your laptop testing things out, have at it. Launch 20 containers at the same time and see how fast that happens. Obviously, when there's not so many people in the room working on it. See how fast it will actually launch multiple, like, multitude of containers for you, all load balanced and all running the services that you want, and in a scale-out fashion. So I'm going to copy and start this here. So I want you to see it happen in the background as I actually launch this. It would be so much more fun if we actually could. Did I lose connection? Oh. Now I lost internet connectivity altogether. Both my sessions, buddy session, and the browser stopped. So we had a brief interruption in the internet. Did everybody, did anybody else have a network drop? Okay. So I'm back online. I'm gonna run that command with two nodes or two containers. Those two containers are gonna run Nginx, and they're gonna be running listening on port 80. So you see them in cockpit getting created. They're still light. That means they're still not online. When their color turns dark blue, they are online and they're listening. There's one service here, the Kubernetes service. And there's one node right now. And we have our Nginx servers running. In the next step in the lab, we're going to load balance them, so they will be listening on port 80 and on the outside network. So we are just going to run the next command to run them on a load balanced service. And that instantly going to create that service in Kubernetes cockpit. Correct. This needs to go out to the public network via OpenStack. I'll take that with you separately outside if you like. So when these two come online, they obviously are taking their time to come online. They usually come online within seconds. They will automatically plug into the load balancer, which is right this guy, and they will start servicing the requests. If there is a failure on one of the nodes, they will automatically relaunch on different nodes that are available. Okay, just briefly covering the rest of the lab here. So you are, so if you're doing it on your own, you get, you know what that's for. There it is. Really, the next steps, we're just going to delete those services so you could, you see how to actually launch new services, how fast it does that, and how you can quickly delete services, and that's that. You just delete the service, and you delete the load balancer, and you're all set. If you have questions, please find me on Twitter. I'm Al Khari on Twitter. And digitalwritings.com has that full details of setting up your instances if you want to know what to install and how to configure networking and all that stuff. Kubernetes.io has phenomenal documentation, a lot of different examples and scenarios you can run on here. You could do it right out of the box. You could just go and just read what the scenario they're trying to do and deploy different services. You could deploy a full stack, if you like, a back-end database server, an application server, a front-end, a full stack of applications within seconds. And once you got multiple minions, multiple nodes on there, it'll automatically do the load balancing for you. It'll automatically do the scale out for you. Give it a try if you have a chance. Go through some of those documents. They will really help out in helping you understand all the different multitude of scenarios you could build. Now, why are we doing this? If you consider that Google actually runs all on containers, and Google runs something to the tune of about 2 billion containers every single day. That's how important containers are today. You have an OpenStack cluster that you built in your environment, and you want to try things out, use it for something useful. If you have, if you don't have that, and you're interested in learning how containers work, Docker in itself is a great container technology, but without orchestration, it's really just a container host. There are multiple orchestrators out there. The Docker folks will tell you Swarm is the way to go, and it's so much better than Kubernetes. There are so many ways to skin a cat. This is one of them. Try this, try Swarm, see if Swarm works better for you. See if it has better application for what you're doing. But don't discount containers, and OpenStack is a great platform to develop your containers on. It provides you with infrastructure as a service tools, really straightforward to build whatever it is that you're trying to do with your PaaS. If you have any questions, please ask me outside or reach out on Twitter or on iNode. I'm Al Khari, as I said. We're going to stick around here for a few more minutes. We have 5 more minutes. But without the second node coming online, we're not going to be able to demonstrate the failover options. So with that, I want to thank you very much for being here today. And happy summit. Thank you.